The deeper idea comes from this idea that I just dished out to you. Do you know why you don't hurt somebody? Or why you behave morally with other people? The same spirit that is percolating through these eyes and looking at you here is percolating through those eyes. I'm stuck. The reason why I can't hurt somebody is because I'm hurting myself. The same spirit. Spirit is never plural. It's percolating here, it's percolating there. So how can I hit myself? It's like hitting myself, hurting myself. So it's the most natural law. It doesn't come because a God looking, supervising. You are stuck with the rest of the living kingdom. You are stuck. So that's why you don't hurt. And why should you help? And again, look at the language of Hinduism. It says, when you help somebody, don't use the word charity. It's a very demeaning comment. When you help somebody, what have you done? You helped yourself. Why make a fuss about it? You've taken a little bit of money from this pocket and put it in this pocket. I'm so charitable. That's not charity. Don't demean it. Don't demean this exercise. It is natural for you to help, but you are stuck with a living kingdom. We are all stuck. So even though I presented this very broad idea of why reverence for life, why this idea of helping others and not hurting others comes naturally. You look, which religion or which theology has got anything like this at all? Show me one. You can show me, you know, Buddhism and Jainism. They talk same language. They don't use the same vocabulary, but they offer the same themes. You see, this is again like a deeper idea about religion without reference to a theos, no God coming in the picture. In a way, it's nice because this, in a way, makes us responsible in a very natural manner, not because some God is going to whack us, but because we are stuck with each other. See the power of this teaching. And when you present this kind of broad vision to a, suppose you are doing social sciences, and in a social sciences, they'll tell you, look, you know, religions are just a ploy. You know, they'll give you Durkheim, the quote Durkheim. So, you know, this is just a social ploy. You know, basically society learning to live with each other and learning to live with itself and how to regulate itself. It produces all this moral guidance and moral laws in the name of God and religion. Okay, it's just a ploy. Guys, wake up. You see, we have to, Hindus have to smile and say, we don't dislike you. We agree that it's a, in a way a bit of a ploy. At the same time, there's one trump card that religion has which social science doesn't have. Let me show you the trump card. At best, social sciences will teach us how we can learn to live with each other. That means, look, I will not step on your toes, you don't step on my toes, let's sign an agreement. You know, at best, it will tell you how to do commerce with each other or between us as a whole group. How to do commerce so that we can coexist in a peaceful manner. That's all we can do as a social science. And the aim of social science is to teach you how to tweak the knobs. How to adjust the law, how to adjust this and that particular features, how to become more egalitarian, and how to make sure that we can live peacefully because we are just being fair to everybody, so that everybody's kept in their place, and things work out well. So they teach you how to tweak the knobs of controlling society. Social science at the best can teach you how to live with each other. Religion, especially your religion that I just talked about, doesn't just teach you how to live with each other, it tells you how to live for each other. See the difference? Now you see, whenever you find a family that is able to live, where the members are able to live for each other, will be the cohesive family. It'll work well. The father doesn't live for himself, he lives for his children. The mother doesn't live for herself, she lives for her children. And hopefully his children one day will do the same back or throw them in the old people's homes. The thing is, this is what religion teaches. It is, if you like, not just learning to live each other, saying, when you were little, you gave me pocket money, so when you're grown up, I'll give you some money. It's not that way. It's terrible. It's very rude. It's degrading. I'm stuck with you. Just as you are looking after me, I have no choice but to look after you. Living for each other, not living with each other. This is the trump card. If you give it to anybody in social sciences, when I take it to the humanist, they say, Jay, how do I fight you now? This is, where do you get this stuff from? How can we live for others? I say, oh, this is how we start. And they love me. See, look, go to Hindu Academy website, and from the front page you get a link to the British humanist website. 5,000 word, initially very rude exchange, saying, Jay, there's a reconciliation between spiritual humanism and you chaps. They say, no, there's no reconciliation. We are different. You got millions of God, we got no God. And this is how we start the conversation. At the end of it, you see how it comes out. 5,000 word exchange. We steal their hearts because the ideas we possess are so dramatic. They steal the hearts. This is how you win in modern society? one way is music. The way you win in modern society is through the power of words, power of thought. If you have powerful thoughts, potent powerful ideas, you dish it out. It's the force of reasoning that will win arguments, not, if you like, physical violence. That's the last thing you want. Because humanity has evolved, we do not need to solve human problems through violence. We can solve them using this. And this is where Hinduism comes into its own. It comes out very strong.